those trials, just as a review, and then we were gonna do a few more designs that fall under the rubric of pragmatic or real. So we'll talk about cluster randomized trials, one of my favorite designs, the stepped wedge, although I've never done one, I've done something similar, and N of one, and then spend some time on patient engagement, which was meant to be the main topic today. What it is, why it's important, how we can do it, and how you can actually measure your level of patient engagement. So if we remember last time, when we talked about the whole issue of pragmatic trials, we looked at that continuum. So it's not yes or no, it's a continuum between explanatory or efficacy trials, your standard RCT, and your more pragmatic trials or effectiveness trials. So lots of interchangeable terminology. And you know, most studies are somewhere in the middle. So if you're looking at the who, what, when, where sort of questions, you know, if we're looking at what, the efficacy is more about can the treatment work under ideal conditions, that allows us to look at causality and hypothesis testing, whereas effectiveness is does treatment actually work in the real world setting. So usually it's more comparative efficacy, looking at different treatments and see which is better. And then the question of why, again, the cause and effect. Here for pragmatic says why do you do it is to inform decision makers. That may be one of the why. Another one is to see if it can be implemented, to try and sort of disseminate it. And I think next week we do knowledge translation, so that'll fit into that. How do we do it, or what kind of methods? In the efficacy trial, as we all know, we're trying to maximize internal validity, so very little variability, very rigid protocol, homogeneous patient groups, very standardized, manualized protocols. And then in the pragmatic trials, we're trying to maximize generalizability, so there's a lot more variability. The protocol might be flexible and more reflect usual care. It's often delivered by non-specialist providers, so people who would actually be doing it in the community. Again, who are the participants? A selective narrow inclusion versus more broad inclusion criteria. And then the methods we use are different as well. So there's more data collection than would be usual in your efficacy trial, and the outcomes are typically relevant to research, although for our type of research, where we're looking at quality of life and psychosocial outcomes, they tend to be more relevant to patients. So it's not just like disease progression, or it's actually how people are feeling and their own self-reported outcomes. And then the pragmatic trials, again, we're looking at clinically relevant things that are important to patients. And the data collection is usually what would already be collected as part of usual care. So that can be challenging in our case because often there's not too much self-reported or psychosocial outcomes in usual care. And so there's this tool, the PRECI2, that we applied to the MATCH study, and that we're actually, for people who don't know, probably only Akarsh knows, we had decided to write a paper on the exercise we did in class last time where we assigned numbers to the MATCH study. We're actually going to submit that as an example of trying to do a pragmatic trial in integrative oncology. So we're actually writing that up right now. We're going to submit it to, there's a special issue of the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine on integrative oncology, and they had a call for papers. So I wanted to talk about pragmatic trials, and so we decided to talk about it in the context of applying this criteria to MATCH study. So something we did in class is actually going to result in a paper, and I bet you CHR will like that.
Awesome.
Yes. So you rate your study on these different dimensions, and it's like a 1 to 5 scale. So you look at the eligibility, so how narrow or broad is it, and the higher scores go to the more pragmatic trials. So the higher your sort of total score, the more pragmatic you are. What was your recruitment method? So how much extra effort did you put into it? And anything that's over and above usual care is more on the efficacy side instead of the pragmatic. And the setting is important too. So did you do it in a regular clinic setting in the community, or is it kind of a special research center? And then how did you organize the delivery? How flexible was it? Again, was it a very narrow protocol, or was it sort of more flexible? And what about adherence, right? So we know that in our efficacy trials, we always talk about treatment fidelity, and we want to make sure that all the providers are doing the same thing. In your pragmatic trials, it doesn't matter so much. The same with the follow-up is another criteria. So again, in efficacy, we might have very stringent multiple follow-up points, whereas in a pragmatic trial, you just follow them up like you would usually in usual care. And then how do you choose your outcome? How relevant is it, and how do you analyze the data, or you know, are you doing intent to treat, or just sort of taking the data that's available? So the things that would get high scores on being pragmatic are probably the things we would think is bad methodology, the way we've been trained. but actually it's good methodology if you're trying to generalize and implement some of these things. So we talked about preference-based trials. I'll review that briefly. Cluster randomized trials, and step which, and N of one we're going to do. So this is the general preference-based design we talked about last time for as it relates to the MATCH study. So people are asked if they have a preference for an intervention. If they do, they get the one they want, so they are not randomized. If they have no preference, then they are randomized into the same interventions. And that allows us to compare the difference between the interventions for people who chose it and the difference between the interventions for people who randomized. So that's your efficacy, that's your effectiveness, essentially. And then you can lump together all the people in one intervention here and compare them to all the people in the other intervention. And that isolates, by comparing the preference to the randomized of the same intervention, that isolates the effective preference. You can do that for both, and then combine them all together on the bottom here so you have the sample size where you're just looking at more mediation correlational data. So those are the benefits of the preference-based design. Then we looked at, this is the design for the MATCH study, which is basically like that, but twice. So the extra thing in here, so the green is all the preference side, the blue is all the randomized side, and the extra lines here are just that there's a second level of randomization into intermediate or wait list. So that gives us the ability to compare to usual care in all the different arms. Any questions on that? That's sort of a review from last time. Good? Okay. Now we have a nice video. Let's see if it works. So we're going to talk about cluster randomized trials.
Cluster randomized trial is a trial in which we randomize groups or clusters of individuals rather than the individuals themselves. So these groups or clusters that we randomize are usually pre-existing groups. So they could be, for example, patients within a hospital or a clinic, or they can be schools or geographical areas or towns. So we could randomize any of those entities, and that would be a cluster randomized trial. In health services research, by far the commonest reason for doing a cluster randomized trial is because you have an intervention which actually aimed at the cluster. So this might, for example, be reorganization of services, or it might be education for the health professionals who are part of the cluster, and other sorts of interventions where it's primarily aimed at the cluster. You might have other bits of the intervention which are aimed at the individual, but most of the intervention is actually aimed at the cluster, and it's therefore very, very difficult to do the intervention, to do the trial in any other way than to cluster randomize it. But there are a few other reasons why you might do a cluster randomized trial, and people often talk about contamination as one of those reasons. That's important if you've got, say, an infectious disease trial, where if you have individuals who are randomized to intervention and control and they mix with each other, then if you give an intervention which is preventing the infectious disease to the intervention group and they mix with the control group, then some of that preventive effects might naturally rub off onto the control group. So you want to separate those who get the intervention and the control somehow, and the easiest way to do that is to do cluster randomization. So that's another situation where they use. In other situations, it might be logistically or ethically difficult to randomize individuals. And so there's one example of a trial that was done in Zimbabwe, and it was on antenatal care. And what they wanted to do was to give those in the intervention group 12 sessions of antenatal care, and in the control group, they were only getting 6 sessions of antenatal care. And after discussion, it seemed that it was going to be very, very difficult to try and offer both of those types of system within one clinic. So they randomized, they cluster randomized that study rather than randomizing individuals. So that's the sort of range of instances where you might do a cluster randomized trial. However, I would say that the sort of important features of a cluster randomized trial is that by cluster randomizing, you make your trial larger, you need a larger sample size, and also you add complexity, so everything becomes more complex in a cluster randomized trial, and you can introduce particular sources of bias which are particular to these trials and don't occur in other trials. So my advice would be, if you can do another design, an individually randomized trial, rather than a cluster randomized trial, then do that. Only do a cluster randomized trial if you really, really need to.
So to end on a low note. Okay. So this is what it would look like. So you've got your, this one goes across instead of up and down. I couldn't find a good up and down one. So you've got clusters of participants. So in our case, the best example is, say, clinicians, right, working in a certain tumor group or in a certain cancer center that you want to do some training on, say, right? And so you can randomize GI cancer is going to get it and breast cancer is not going to get it or something like that, right? So you randomize the clusters. So the ones randomize the intervention will get the intervention, and the cluster randomized not to get it won't get it. But then you do individual outcome assessment on the individual patients, not on the cluster. So there's individual pre-post data on, say, a patient who goes to the breast clinic compared to a patient who goes to the GI clinic. And the intervention might be some kind of training. Or, for example, so the examples I have here are things that we've actually tried to do. So you're educating health professionals. Well, so they talk about contamination, right? She talked about actual, like, sort of viral contamination, but there's, like, the idea of, like, sort of psychological contamination. Like, what would happen, right, if you're randomly educating some oncologists but not the others? Like, what would happen?
They share information.
Yeah. They're going to be like, hey, what are you doing over there? Right? And the actual issue here, too, is also there's contamination across tumor groups, because lots of oncologists see more than one type of cancer, right? So if I train an oncologist in, for example, how to do screening for distress or to refer patients for an exercise program, right? Because you can, a lot of these interventions might be actually trying to introduce a change of practice, right? That might be routine distress screening and triage, or it might be exercise prescriptions, right? That's another really common kind of integrative oncology intervention. But that's the problem, is if you get one oncologist doing it in breast clinic and tell them not to do it in GI clinic, it's the same oncologist, right? They're going to probably do it. And then if some see their colleagues doing it, they're like, hey, what's that you're doing there, right? So that's the sort of psychological contamination. So when we wrote a grant to do screening for distress, this was before it was, it's now implemented provincially, but before it was, we ended up doing Calgary versus Edmonton. So we were going to do the Tom Baker versus the Cross, right? And so we would look at the clinics within those, actually the entire cancer center is what we were going to do. And we submitted that to CIHR, but it didn't get funded, you know, because there's issues around that too, right? So if we randomize people from Tom Baker to get the screening for distress and our patients do better, is it because the Cross didn't have the screening for distress, or is it because things are just different at the Cross, right? It's not the same environment. So there are other issues around that, but there's no other way that you can do a lot of these trials. So I think it's actually, it falls under the rubric of pragmatic trials, right? Because it is very practical, right? And it, you know, it's like, for example, schools, these are often done in, right? If you want to, another area, there's a lot of research is mindfulness training in schools, and they often do it by either entire schools will be randomized to get it or not get it, or school districts, or even classrooms within schools, or grades within schools, right? And so that's almost always how those types of implementation studies are done. You know, and the nice thing, I'm going to get to step wedge and stuff like that, is, but the nice thing is that once you introduce the intervention, eventually to all the clusters or all the groups, then they have it and you can keep it going. You don't have to take it away and you can still evaluate it. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay, so the next one is step wedge. So this is the idea that the intervention is introduced to participants in staggered time periods. So this can, these groups here can be individuals, person A, B, C, D, E, F, or they can be clusters. A, B, C, D, E, F. And so let's pick an intervention. So say it's exercise prescriptions, right? So maybe you start with, you could start with individual oncologists doing it, or you could start with clinics doing it. And so at the first assessment, you assess how much the patient, so the unit of analysis is the patient. You want them to exercise. So you can assess how many of these patients are getting their, you know, required dose of exercise, whatever, how you want to do it. And then you introduce the intervention to this randomly, one group, but not the others. So now you have one on, five off, right? And then the next month or 6 months later, whatever your time periods are, you introduce it to the next unit. So you have two on and four off, right? And then 2 months later, whatever the time period is, you introduce it to the next group. And these are randomly selected, the order of introduction, until eventually they all have it. And so with the analysis, it's complicated, but you're able to compare at each time point the ons versus the offs, right? And so are the patients who have it always going to be exercising more than the patients who don't have it? And in the end, you've got this big group here that you compare with this group here, right? So you've got lots of people in your sample size at the end. Go on in. Just in time for step wedges. Wouldn't want to miss that. So this is, again, a really pragmatic design, right? Because you want to introduce an intervention anyway. Like, and I wish this would have happened with, say, screening for distress, because the way it was done in Alberta was not done with the research focus. It was handed off from the research team to the sort of clinical team, and they just sort of did it without really measuring it very well, but they could have done this, right? Mm-hmm. It would have been pretty easy. And in fact, they kind of did do this, but they didn't do the measurements really regularly to be able to compare, because they stopped measuring the people off, right? They just measured the people on the protocol. But if, say, any kind of program, like I was just talking with an oncologist about introducing cannabis clinical practice guidelines and referral, like triage algorithms in oncologists, so that they would actually have guidelines for, okay, who should I prescribe cannabis to and what are the steps, right? And now they don't do it at all. So if we wanted to implement that, this would be a good way to evaluate it, right? We could say, okay, we're going to start with, and you could maybe start with clinics, or you might start with, you know, Tom Baker and then the cross, but probably it would be clinic after clinic after clinic, and there might be a bit of contamination, right? But then you can compare the patients. So you have all these people on study, maybe it's everybody, or you have a group of patients on study, but a lot of them are going to be studied for months and months before they even get the intervention. So you have this, what's called multiple baselines, right? So we'd have, say, 100 patients in each group or something like that from each clinic, you know, and then we'd see, okay, what are the symptoms of all the patients at the beginning? And then once these guys got the intervention, so they had access to their cannabis or whatever it was, did their symptoms change compared to all these other guys who were randomly assigned? So, you know, ostensibly all the same. Right, and so as you gradually add the intervention to the different clinics, eventually everyone gets it, but you're able to evaluate its efficacy or effectiveness at the same time. So in my mind, you should never introduce a clinical program that you're planning to introduce without this kind of evaluation, which is very pragmatic, right? So I don't know why people don't do
that. So can the analysis be done post-hoc?
Well, it's a good question, right? If you could get the data from the off people, like if it was database data,
right,
you know, institutional data, you might be able to. And actually that, we have more regular data collection now with the screening for distress that's going on. And so they do, you know, the ESAS items, so lots of symptom monitoring. It doesn't happen necessarily at all the same time points for every person, and it doesn't happen in every clinic.
Yeah.
But if you could map that on to some change in program delivery that happened, again, if you could mark the time points, and then you'd have to match time points in the databases with time points of the program. You could do it, but it's, you can see it'd be way harder than pre-planning it, right? So anytime you're looking at any change of practice, I think this is really a good protocol for trying to do it. And you have to have those assessments at each time point, right? You know, or to be able to compare the groups.
Especially it's like for the MHAP, like, you know, mobile health stuff, that this could easily be there because it's easier to get data on an ongoing basis. When you just ask people or not,
you know,
it's
and
like,
you know, even you could even sign people up as they started to get the intervention and get permission to go back and get their data if it was already been collected, right? Because the difficulty is getting everyone to sign up at the beginning to get that first data point when you're not going to get the thing for a year or however long it is, right? So to be able to monitor them all these. But if it's already collected, and that would be more pragmatic, right? If it's data we're already collecting as part of usual care, you know, and some of that would be collected, like medications and, you know, stuff like that. And that's probably what we should do when we introduce the integrative oncology plan program too, like the consultation to think about that. And then the next one is the stepped wedge with clusters, which is almost what I was talking about. So this just puts those two together, right? So we talked about randomizing clusters and assessing individuals within clusters. Here you can sort of step the the intervention through the clusters. So let's just go through this. So this is a parallel cluster study. So basically you've got three clusters that are always on, that's the intervention, and three clusters that are always off, your control. So that's really just like your standard parallel randomized controlled trial, except you're randomizing clusters. So again, clusters can be clinics, it can be classrooms, it can be hospitals, it can be anything. So that's your basic one. And here is a similar thing, except you have a run-in time. So the light color here is all the control that's not getting the intervention. So you have this sort of what we often call multiple baseline, so multiple assessments before some of them get the intervention. So you have this, you know, hopefully you're able to graph it where whatever your outcome is, it's very steady, and then when they get the intervention, the scores go up or the scores go down. And the other group, they stay the same, so they should map on to what's happening with the timing of the intervention. And then this C is your conventional stepped wedge. So it's just the upside down with what I just showed you, right? It's the same idea. You know, so everybody gets at least one baseline. These guys get two baselines, right? These guys get three baselines. These guys get four baselines until they finally get the thing. You know, so that's your conventional stepped wedge. You can do it again with clusters. And this one here has got a transition. Now, I'm not sure what happens in the transition on this one. The transition from the control to the intervention. Maybe that's a training period or something like that where you don't assess people. I'd have to read the article in more detail this came from to figure out. Anybody have any ideas? What could be the transition?
Is it like the washout period?
It could be if the first intervention was, say, medication. Yeah. So that's true because there's also a crossover design, which I didn't go over, where crossover designs are only appropriate for things that are time limited, right? So I actually did a crossover study once with the Reiki design, and a crossover is that each participant gets both interventions, but it has this period of, if you know how long it takes for the drug to get out of the system or the acupuncture to wear off, which we were wrong about actually. We gave, I don't know, I think 2 weeks or a month for the acupuncture to wear off, but they were still better than they were at the beginning. So it could be that. It could be a washout if the control intervention is some kind of drug or some kind of procedure that might be improving, you know, their outcomes. And then you'd have the transition or the washout, or maybe it's a training period or something like that, and then introduce the intervention. So can we think of some examples where you might use these in your own areas? Come on, I already gave you a bunch. No? I'm going to sit here until someone gives me.
So I would think, I was thinking, for me the cluster, you know, would be a group of users that I could isolate by, you know, where they are geographically. Looking at cancer patients or cancer survivors who are who use smartphones and who can get the intervention by MHAT. So, you know, by location, that would be the cluster.
A cluster should be naturally occurring groups.
Yeah, so like you'd be able to identify them based on that, you know, where they live.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be the naturally occurring group. So it would be by location and by remote location. And people who don't have access to an urban health center, you know, across the timing of the intervention. That I think the second one, like the parallel cluster study with the baseline period, that's what makes sense for me right
mm-hmm.
now.
Yeah, that makes sense. Because so in your case, the clusters, like in Alberta, we have 17 different cancer centers, and some of them are tertiary, and some are community cancer centers, right? So you could look at the community cancer centers as, and which are geographically based as a cluster, right? And you could say, okay, I'm going to introduce this to all the people in that cluster first, you know, and then you'd still, though, the problem with these is that you have to identify the participants in all the other clusters at the same time to be able to assess the multiple
right.
baselines, right? So that's, I think, the difficult thing is that you have to actually know who everyone's going to be, unless you can go back retrospectively and get it from administrative data. Yeah, so, you know, and I think the other examples from exercise that I talked about is, you know, introducing you know, some kind of exercise intervention to standard care. So if it's going to be, you know, stationary bikes in the inpatient units or something like that, right, you could also do that by hospital or something like that. Okay, any questions about the clusters or the staff wedge? Make sense? So N of one studies. This one actually, I think,
Hey, welcome to Sketchy EBM. I'm your host, Anthony Crocco, and today we're talking about N of one studies. At some point or another, you may have asked yourself the question, what is the best type of research study out there? You've probably seen an evidence-based medicine pyramid before.
Right,
these usually have things like expert opinion at the bottom. Somewhere in the middle, there are things like case-controlled trials or randomized control trials. And then as we move to the top, usually you get systematic reviews, some by Cochrane, and then evidence-based guidelines. The major limitation of any of the studies I've mentioned so far is that at best, they just give you a probability of your patient doing well. Even if there's a 75% chance that your patient will benefit, it means that there's a 25% chance that they're not going to benefit. If only there was a study design that could tell you whether a therapy is good for the patient you have in front of you. Lucky for us, we have such a study design, and it's called the N of one study. Let's spend a minute talking about how N of one studies are done. First of all, we start with the patient that we're treating. The patient has to be blinded as to which therapy they're getting at any given time. After all, we want to keep bias out of our results. Next, we randomize periods of time where the patient receives therapy A, which may be an experimental therapy or a control therapy, and we document how the patient performs on whatever metrics are important to us. We also randomize the patient to receive therapy B, which may be another control or therapeutic option. And again, measure the outcome variables we're interested in. It's important that whoever is measuring these variables is also blinded to the therapeutic option the patient is receiving. Again, we want to avoid bias in our study. After we've collated our results, we can then sort out, did the patient do better when they were getting therapy A or therapy B? And we'll know for that specific patient, what is the best therapeutic option? So what are the advantages and disadvantages of the N of one study? Let's start off with some of the disadvantages. The first is that not all therapeutic options lend themselves well to randomization for an individual patient. As an example, you couldn't have an N of one study for two different approaches to an appendectomy. If you have appendicitis, you really only get one surgical kick at the can. The ideal therapeutic options have rapid onset and short duration of effect. A second challenge with N of one studies is ensuring that there's a clinically relevant outcome measure that you're going to look at. A third consideration is time. N of one studies can take weeks, if not months, to complete. A fourth challenge with N of one studies is that they're not really publishable, which means it's hard to learn from other people who have done them, and you're not likely to get your N of one study published. Academic careers are not really made on the backs of N of one studies. A last consideration are the types of people you have to have involved for an N of one study. Your patient will need to have the capacity for cooperation and compliance. Chances are you're also going to need a pharmacist who can provide you with randomized blinded samples for you to provide to your patient. By now, you're probably thinking that N of one studies sound like a logistical nightmare. There is, however, one good reason to do them, and that's your patient. Instead of telling a patient that a therapy probably will work for them, it allows us to tell them that this therapy does work for them. So at the end of the day, even though there are a ton of challenges doing an N of one study, it really is the most patient-centered research that we can perform. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Sketchy EBM. Please do take the time to evaluate, and as always, remember to draw your own conclusions.
I like Sketchy. Okay. So, obviously I was talking about drugs. What are some applications that you could think of for integrative oncology? You're gonna write them down. So I'll tell you about one study we did. So we did the Reiki study that I was just talking about. So sort of an N of one, but it was actually with multiple people, but it's the same design, right? So N of one is a crossover, and it's randomly determined which of the two treatments they get first. So we did that with the Reiki study, and we were trying to look at fatigue, because people say that Reiki increases the energy flow and people will be less fatigued. So we compared Reiki to rest. Obviously, people are not blinded. They know that they're resting or getting Reiki, right? And there, it's self-assessments, because we're looking at fatigue, and there's no other way. I can't look at you and say, oh, no, you're not fatigued, right? There's no other way to rate fatigue. So two of the criteria that they talk about are not there, and that's often the case with behavioral interventions. But what we did is 5 days of Reiki, and before and after each session, people rated their fatigue, and the very beginning, they rated their fatigue. And then we did the washout, right, or the crossover to rest. Or so they either did the 5 sessions of Reiki, or they rested for an hour a day for 5 days. So they did the rest. And then we measured fatigue, and then we crossed them over. So they said in the video, it has to be fast-acting, short-lasting treatments, right? So, well, we figured that the Reiki, you know, would wear off fairly quickly. And I think it was 2 weeks we gave the Reiki, but and then switched them over to rest. But then when we looked at the pre-post fatigue, it never went back up to the level it was pre-Reiki. Anyway, it turned out that, and you can look at each individual, right? Because you've got all these little N1s, or you can lump them together, that it actually was effective for reducing fatigue. And that was an honor student project that we published. You know, we had 20 people or something. But when they each get both interventions, it doubles your power to compare the two groups. So that was one example of an integrative oncology intervention where we could use that methodology. So what are some other possible examples? It's obviously not going to work with exercise, right? Probably not going to work with meditation.
Come on, people.
How about products? That would probably be the most obvious thing, right? Because they are drugs, basically. What else could we try? How about a certain diet? We try that if it's a fatigue-reducing diet. It depends what your outcome is, right? What about treatments for pain, yeah?
Light
therapy. Yeah, we've done that study, right, on light therapy, but we never, I didn't even think of that. good one. Yeah, you could totally do that. I mean, anything that's only, you could do acupuncture, right? Anything that's only supposed to work while you're doing it. Acupuncture doesn't, I think, have really long-lasting effects, or it's not meant to, as far as I understand it. But basically anything that is supposed to work while you do it and not work while you don't do it, right? That's a pretty good list. Any other ideas? I mean, it could be Tai Chi. That's a tough one, though, because you also learn certain things that are long-lasting, right? Similar to meditation. You definitely couldn't do meditation.
Or yoga.
Well, I don't know. I mean, that's the thing, right? Yoga definitely has some things that only are beneficial while you do it, right? But there's other things, components to it that probably change the way that you are, that it's permanent or longer-lasting. But these are also pragmatic designs that are also, remember, if we go back to orbit, like these are kind of things that would be good in the phase 1A, 1B, right, when you're trying to develop your interventions, so to sort of try these kind of methodologies.
What about individual counseling? Would that be...
That's supposed to be very long-lasting.
Right.
But something like hypnosis, maybe not, right?
Yeah. Would they just come for a session, experience relaxation during the session?
Okay, so that could be relaxation training then. So individual counseling, though, is thought to be more like,
right,
you know, insight-oriented, and, you know, sort of people are learning things they can't unlearn, right? But yeah, I think hypnosis, relaxation training even, you know, you could think of as being sort of temporary things. So there's actually lots of different integrative oncology interventions that might fit with those. And I don't know if they can be published. You know, probably they would need to be published with some kind of qualitative component and with interviews to sort of flesh it out. But adding in some of this more systematic measurement of outcomes, you know, when you're on it, when you're off it, when you're on something else, when you're off. It's sort of this A-B-A-B design, you know, on, off, and crossing over and randomly signing people is a lot better than just kind of giving them a thing and then getting their opinion on it, right? an improvement to a lot of the qualitative stuff that people are already publishing. All right, so that was it for the pragmatic trials, and then we're going to go to patient engagement. But before we do that, are there any other comments or questions around pragmatic research, real-world research? Is anybody sort of doing anything more pragmatic as a result of discussions that we've had?
Yes.
Yeah. Percolates. I know Kirsty's thinking about it too. She's thinking a lot more about the orbit model and planning her PhD too, in trying to phase things in a little more. And it certainly made, it's helped me, like when we did the PRAISE-2 wheel on the MATCH study and now writing this paper, has really helped think about the different elements, like the 9 elements that they talk about, and, you know, how would we make our trials more pragmatic? Do we want to make our trials more pragmatic? You know, can we, would it make sense to have a really big wheel, right? And then sort of justify it under that system. So it's interesting to think about this stuff for sure. And a lot of it sort of flies in the face of the kind of training we've got on efficacy trials, which is, you know, what most of us learn in our PhD program. So, okay, so I'll go on to patient engagement. This is the one I was going to warn you about that has no narration. It's just words. Read Max. Can everybody see it? Is it mostly reading this one? Widely used definition for patient engagement is meaningful and active collaboration and governance, priority setting, conducting research, and knowledge translation. So patient engagement is much broader than research. I'm mostly going to focus on it in a research context because that's what we do. But really, the broader scale of patient engagement is around everything, right? It's like how we set policy, healthcare policy, what services are provided, what services are paid for, you know, how we move research into practice. So the idea of patient engagement is much broader than just research, but there's a lot of work within how do we engage patients in research specifically. So patient-oriented research, so the SPORE, the thing that the Traction program is funded by is called the SPORE program, which is a strategy for patient-oriented research. And the whole point of SPORE through CIHR is to promote patient-oriented research. So they define it as a continuum of research that engages patients as partners, focuses on patient-identified priorities, and improves patient outcomes. And so patient-oriented research is conducted by a multidisciplinary team in partnership with all sorts of relevant stakeholders, primarily patients, and apply the knowledge generated through research to improve healthcare systems and practices. So the ultimate goal is to actually improve the sort of healthcare that people are getting systematically. So in Canada, CIHR, through the SPORE, the Strategy for Patient-Oriented Research, is the main body that's promoting this type of research. And their vision is that patients are active partners in health research that will lead to improved health outcomes and an enhanced healthcare system. And in the States, it's a body called PCRI, Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, and they partner with NIH. And their vision is that patients and the public have information they can use to make decisions that reflect their desired health outcomes. So it's much broader. It's not as specific to sort of research and knowledge dissemination as the CIHR SPORE platform is. So this, I don't know if you can see it, but this is a summary of, I put a whole document on D2L, that's the CIHR, I think it's called Putting Patients First Framework. It's like a whole document that they base sort of all their funding on. And again, the vision is that patients are active partners in health research. It will lead to improved health outcomes and enhanced healthcare system. And their specific objective is to establish key concept principles and areas for patient engagement that they want all of us to do. And the desired outcomes are to have inclusive mechanisms and processes for including patients in research, promote respectful collaboration among patients, researchers, and healthcare providers, to make sure the experiential knowledge of patients is valued as evidence and part of the research process, the research is informed and co-directed by patients, and the common goal of timely implementation of quality research through the involvement of patients. And the guiding principles are things like inclusiveness, support, mutual respect, and co-building. That all sounds great, right? Who's doing this? Are any of you? Does anybody have a patient involved in your research? Yeah?
I'm hoping to.
Yay! Yeah.
And
I don't either right now, right? So I've been on, and only because it's not easy, right? If I could ask a patient tomorrow and have them join our group, then I would, but you can't actually, because I'll tell you, but the mechanisms that the systems they've set up aren't that easy to work with, but it makes you feel silly that if you're not doing this, right? It's so obvious, you know, and so we're not doing it, right? And we really should be, so that's something that, and we're also funded by SPORE, so all you people should be, you know, and it doesn't have to be that hard. So there's this, I'll show you this. So this is, again, from the CIHR SPORE document, and then I'll show you this sort of framework of degrees of patient engagement. So they could be research committee members to help planning, designing, and guiding the project as it progresses, involvement in decision-making process, and bringing forward priority issues for research. So, you know, I mean, it's just hard because mostly when you gather a group of people together, you already have a project in mind, right? There's something you want to do. So you don't necessarily want a patient saying, actually, I'm interested in this. You're like, actually, no, we're doing mind-body therapies or we're doing Tai Chi or whatever, right? You know, so at some level, you want to have patients involved at a higher planning, right? And actually, I don't feel that bad because we don't have them on our research committees, but we do surveys all the time. And actually, when I was applying for this, I'm like, oh, we're not very patient-oriented. And I was talking to one of the patient engagement people through the Alberta SPORE platform, and they're like, well, do you ever like survey patients? And I'm like, oh, I got millions of surveys, right? You know, because we did a survey of 500 patients about complementary therapy use in 2012, and Miriam just did another one last year where we asked them, you know, what are you doing? What are you interested in doing? So in a way, we're consulting with them that way, and that is the higher level because we actually are taking their advice. It's like, oh, some are, we're interested in cannabis. Okay, I better study cannabis. Or we're interested in massage. Okay, maybe we should do some massage research, or we're interested in acupuncture. So, you know, even at that level of doing surveys of patients that a lot of us do, we're doing that. But we're not necessarily having them on our committees that design studies. Maybe largely because we don't think they would have the expertise to know what's the best methodology. But they could certainly have ideas about what are the outcomes they care about, right? It's like, oh, you know, you're measuring my blood samples and I couldn't care less what's going on in my cytokines, right? You know, I want you to look at my quality of life or my pain. Who knows what they'd say? Or maybe they'd be like, oh, that's so cool that you're looking at my blood, right? So it makes sense to have them advise you on things like outcomes that are meaningful to them, and maybe not so much on whether you're going to do a stepped wedge or a cluster run, whatever. Although issues around randomization involve them, right? Like, often we ask patients, are you willing to be randomized? Are you, are these acceptable to you, right? And then they talk about them as contributors, and I think this is more what we've done, is identifying the right research questions, study design, recruitment. Like, often we ask patients in pilot work, what's the best time frame for you to do this, or how long an intervention do you want? Data collection. I mean, have we asked them, do you want paper, pencil, or computer? We just say, here's a computer, right? We don't want you to do paper, pencil anymore. Here's a computer. And a lot of them are like, I'd actually rather do the paper, pencil. Like, even with Match, right?
Yeah.
When we first started doing Match, it was all on a computer, and we had them sit down and do it. And it was taking some of them like 2 hours because they weren't very good at using the mouse. And at some point, someone said, can I just do this on a piece of paper? And we're like, oh, yeah, yeah, here. like, wait, I gotta print one out, just stuff like that. We do what's easy for us, but we don't always think about what's best for them. Patients can also have a role in reviewing stories to identify common threads, relevant themes. You know, this is around focus groups. Just to ensure that outcomes important to patients are supported and measured. And I think, I think with some of the research you're doing, right, you're actually starting at the beginning with that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And maybe you can share some of that with people, I don't know if you want to.
So just briefly. So what I'm essentially looking to do is recruit a group of lung cancer survivors for some interviews to get a sense of what is it that's so important to them in terms of barriers and facilitators to participate in my exercise program. And then once I have a little bit more information from those interviews, I would actually like to invite a few of them to be patient researchers and kind of help me tailor that intervention to them. So for example, do you want it to be offered in the morning or in the afternoon? Because typically their fatigue tends to increase during the day and they take naps in the afternoon. So things like that I personally might not find in the literature or wouldn't understand or consider that they could kind of help me with. So not necessarily which research design to use, but things like that could actually really make a difference in the end.
Yeah. And do other people have examples? I know, Julie, you're planning to do some questionnaires. Activity interventions for young adult cancer survivors, right? And we're talking about boxing, are they like that? Like, what sort of thing would appeal to them, right? Anybody else sort of doing patient engagement at this level? That's something to think about. And then they talk about supporters of participant-friendly research studies. So that's more like, here's a study we've been involved with, we like this study, providing access to patients, right, via their networks, survivor networks, peer networks, and helping researchers actually access and recruit difficult-to-reach patients and groups. So patient engagement and patient advocates can be really helpful on that basis, especially now in the world of, social media and networking and stuff like that. So that's different ways that patients can be involved in research. Now this group here, they're called the IAP2, which is actually just IAPP. It used to be the IAP. I mean, I don't know why they have two instead of P. Anyway, It's the International Association for Public Participation. And this is a great big international group. There's a Canada chapter. And I was just looking at their website. And so they are not just in healthcare. They are about public participation all through sort of government and that sort of thing. So their objectives are to encourage the growth and development of the public participation field, techniques to use, the public understanding and participation, so get people involved, improve the quality and professionalism of people in this area, so both professionals and patients. So they do training sessions, meetings, conference seminars. They have an annual meeting. It's all about this patient engagement or public participation, they call it. They do virtual sessions about the science of it, basically, and then dissemination. Publish, edit, or otherwise disseminate to practitioners and the general public, articles, journals, books, monographs. So they have all sorts of materials, and a lot of them are on their website. And just advocate for public participation to be included in all different areas of practice, from public policy to decision making, stuff like that. So it's a kind of a really umbrella organization. And they're the ones who came up with this spectrum of public participation that everybody seems to use, and Cancer Control Alberta uses it too. And the idea is that there's different ways that you can have the public involved, from sort of less involvement around the information to more involvement. So informing is basically you just have a meeting and tell the public what you're doing, right? So provide the public with balanced and objective information to assist them in understanding the problem, alternative opportunities. So the promise of the public is we'll keep you informed, and they use things like fact sheets, websites, open houses, right? So that's really a very basic level of public participation, right? The next sort of step up would be consultation. So this is usually like a one-time sort of survey, and that's the kind of thing most of us have done. So get feedback or analysis on alternatives, decisions. So the sort of goal here is we'll keep you informed, listen to and acknowledge concerns and aspirations, and provide feedback about how your input influences the decision. So we'll take your input, we'll do something with it without you, and then we'll tell you how we did it, right? So public comments, focus groups, surveys, public meetings. And the next step up would be actually involving, so sort of more back and forth conversations, so working directly with the public throughout the process to ensure their concerns and aspirations are understood and considered. So we'll work with you to ensure your concerns and aspirations are directly reflected in the alternatives developed and provide feedback. So they're still not making the decisions, the public, right? So workshops, polling, deliberative polling, so specific sort of samples, you know, this is okay, I'm going to talk to the breast cancer patients about the breast cancer groups, right? And then the next step up is collaboration, and this is, I think, what we would be aspiring to if we had patients on our committees and designing our research and stuff. So partnering with the public in each aspect of the decision, including the development of alternatives and the identification of the preferred solution. So in a research context, that would be really having them involved right from the beginning and making all the decisions around the study. We'll look to you for advice and innovation in formulating solutions and incorporate your recommendations. So advisory committees, consensus building, participatory decision making. And this empowerment, the sort of final step, is to give equal weight, actually to place the decision making in the hands of the public. So even more weight to the public, I guess, right? So it's kind of we collaborate, we come up with different options, and then you guys decide what we're going to do here. So place final decision making in the hands of the public. We will implement what you decide. So you have to be willing to do what they tell you to do if you're going to try and empower the public. So you can have, you know, votes, plebiscites, juries, delegated decisions. So we wouldn't typically do that in healthcare, I don't think. But we could do the involvement piece and the collaboration piece. And, you know, with the surveys and stuff, we often do the consultation piece. So I think it's just a matter of moving up more into, you know, more greater involvement and more collaboration. That is the areas we need to sort of work on. Any comments or questions? So Cancer Control Alberta then has, they have a patient, what do they call it, a patient and family advisors. So they have a person, it used to be this woman Jess, and it's somebody new. And I actually have been trying to schedule a phone call with them for like 2 months. And I was hoping to have it before I had to teach this class so I could tell you what they told me. But in the past, when I talked to them about, I need a patient, you know, to be on my planning committee or whatever, they said, well, it's not that simple, right? You have to apply. First of all, there's a big application thing. And then you have to say exactly what's the engagement activity that you want them involved in and what can they expect in terms of what are the outcomes and the objectives and, you know, what's logical things like with their time commitment, and but also kind of more like what's their role going to be. And then they say that they won't just give me someone, you know, at this level or whatever, that you have to start with these one-off things. They're like, so they have these patient and family advisors that they train to be good patient and family advisors, and they go through a whole sort of criteria of, you know, courses and workshops and all this kind of stuff. And then you apply for one, but then they say, well, first you have to choose one project or questions that you want to ask a person. So they call it one-off engagement method. Or a focus group or interviews, and they're like, we'll get you someone for that, right? And so I'm kind of like, well, I actually want someone to, you know, help me design a study. And they're like, no, you can't start there. And I'm like, well, I don't really need someone for something else. So that's kind of been the barrier for me, is like, okay, should I just ask somebody, or am I supposed to go through this process? And like, no, you got to go through this process. You can't just ask one of your, like, I would ask a study participant or something, you know, who is engaged, like, hey, do you want to actually be on the planning committee? But they're like, no, you have to go through this recommended evolution of engagement methods, right? So you do the one-off engagement thing. So the last time I talked to her, she was like, yeah, you know, you'd have to fill out this questionnaire and let me know exactly what you want to do. So show outcomes, make changes. So basically you use them once, and then you have to prove that you're actually using them properly, and you're respecting what they say, and you're making decisions based on what they say. So show outcomes and make changes with the data gathered from the one-off engagement method. Share these back with the patient and the family advisors, and then you can move on to the next thing. So formation of patient and family-centered care committees. And then at the very highest level, they join these different councils and that kind of stuff. So there's no rush, build relationships, you know, so they're not super helpful is what I found so far. But there's also, so there's sort of two entities. There's the Alberta SPOR Support Unit for Patient Engagement. That's a provincial group that's funded by CIHR, and they're in Edmonton. And they help you write grant applications and provide materials and that kind of stuff. So far, that's what they've done for me. And then there's this Alberta Health Services has a patient engagement group that I haven't worked with. And then Cancer Control Alberta has a specific council that are cancer patients. So those are the people I've tried to work with and haven't had much success yet. But I have a phone call. I think you had to reschedule it because something was double booked, or so it wasn't really their fault. Anyway, so I'm trying to talk to these people about how do I get a patient, right? And so there's also this AHS toolkit, which I think is the last thing I wanted to show you. Which is actually available online, and it's like quite, it's like 27 pages, right? And so this is put out by Alberta Health Services, patient engagement, so it's not specific to cancer. But from reading this, they are suggesting that you go off and do it on your own, it sounds like, that you are just supposed to do this yourself. So, you know, first you have to understand the concept of patient engagement, the background, the purpose, you know, assess the readiness of the group, and then it gives you a whole bunch of information on how to recruit people, which is kind of useful. Selecting patients and family advisors, orienting them. So you have to select them, you have to orient them, you have to support them, you have to monitor progress. Oh yeah, and I'm going to show you a progress monitoring tool too. So this document here has got all sorts of things about what are the benefits, why should you do it, core concepts, you know, about treating people with dignity and respect, like kind of obvious stuff. This is the same spectrum we saw that IAP2, Inform, Consult, Involve, Collaborate, Empower. And, oops, this is not working. Just give me a second. There we go. And so how do you build relationships? Want us to engage patients? Oh, you know, probably because that was from my G drive. And then it goes on and on, actually, and it talks about coming up with a staff liaison. So not the investigator, but but somebody on your staff whose job would be to liaise with the patient and family advisors and to touch base with them and, you know, really make sure that they're really informed and they're getting feedback. And so it's a fairly involved process. And then I wanted to show you also, there's an evaluation questionnaire that is kind of interesting. So the McMaster group has come up with this. It's called Public and Patient Engagement Evaluation Tool. And so the tool has three different parts, and one part is supposed to be filled out by the patient advisor. One part's filled out by, I think, the researchers or the organization. And I'm not sure who the other part's supposed to be filled out by. Let's see if I can pull it up. See if that one works. So it says guidelines for the organizations, obtain participants' assessment of key features of the engagement activity they participate in. So it's supposed to be admitted to, you know, service users, citizens, whoever, right, and other stakeholders. So this is the participant questionnaire, and it's kind of interesting just to give you an idea of, like, what you need to think about when you're engaging patients, because these are the things they think are really important. So the purpose of the activity was clearly explained. The supports I needed to participate were available. I had enough information to contribute to the topic being discussed, so they need background information, right, training. I was able to express my views freely. I felt that my views were heard. You know, and that's just about how a person facilitates conversation. A wide range of views on the topic were expressed. It's supposed to happen. My input will be considered by the organizers. The activity achieved its stated objectives. So when you apply to get a patient advisor, you have to say, like, what are the goals? What are the objectives? I understand how the input from this activity will be used. I think it will make a difference. I feel better informed about whatever. I have greater trust in whoever. I was satisfied. It was a good use of my time. So those are the kind of things you need to keep in mind when you're thinking about engaging a patient, right? And then they go on, and this is like a, well, it's not populating, but they have a similar kind of thing for people in the organization to rate the patient engagement from their perspective, like, was it useful? And the other document, the toolkit from EHS, has a thing on, like, common pitfalls in patient engagement. You know, and one of the common things that patients say is, like, I felt like it was just a rubber stamp, right? Like, I'm just here because I'm supposed to be here, but they've already made the decisions and they don't really care what I have to say. You know, so I think if you're going to do patient engagement, you have to actually really care about what they're going to say, what their opinions are, and be willing to, you know, act upon them, right? So, you know, don't ask the question if you don't want to hear the answer, right? So that's all I had on patient engagement, because I haven't actually talked to them yet. But it's interesting, right, to read on it, because everyone says we want to do patient engagement, but then when you go to do it, there's not a lot of support for it. Although I did find the toolkit, the AHS one, and I think I put that on your D2L thing as well. Has a lot of good ideas. So we'll see how it all pans out when I finally actually talk to people and say, give me a patient. I'm a patient. See what happens. Oh, sorry, you can't have one. Everybody wants a patient now. You know, and so I think the other alternative would be, even though CCA says we need to go through them, I mean, the AHS toolkit is very much a do-it-yourself sort of thing. You know, how to identify people. It's got like 27 pages on how to screen people, you know, how to provide them background information, how to them for the activities and that kind of stuff. So any questions, comments? I think it's the way things are going. You know, there's a definite shift in funding bodies, like CIHR wants to fund things that show patient engagement, this big PCORI initiative in the States. They're millions of dollars of grants, right? They're huge. And people just don't know how to do it, so they're, you know, they barely get the money away.
Was there interest in, like, you know, like, the hard sciences, like, the, you know, the people who study the drugs and medicine?
Well, they're supposed to do it, too.
Yeah, that's,
I mean, it's way easier for us,
yeah,
right? Because the stuff we do makes sense to people, right? But, yeah, they're supposed to be doing it, too. Like, the people who are, I don't know, doing, like, bench science on mice and stuff are supposed to be asking patients, is this relevant to you?
Right.
You know? So, I mean, it's hard because a lot of that basic science, you know, knowledge that may or may not be important in the future, right?
Yeah.
You don't actually know as you're doing it, it's just discovery,
yeah,
right? So it's like, this might be incredibly important or it might be nothing, right? So how how is a patient supposed to say, well, I think you should do this or that without having the background knowledge? It's much harder. I think it's beneficial to sort of population science and psychosocial science to have patients' input, because for them, a lot of what's important is more clinical stuff, right? Prevention, you know, is trying to do public education around health behaviors and prevention, and then also trying to improve the quality of life of people with different diseases and, you know, decrease symptoms, symptom management, and quality of life, and, you know, all the different distress and depression and anxiety, and all those things are really important to patients. So, yeah. Or through SPOR? No. Nope. No, if so, to get a patient in your study, so SPOR is a funding agency. So if you are looking to get funding, they have a number of different opportunities. So they do small grants. I think they, I don't know if they call them catalyst grants, but they have small SPOR grants, and then they have larger ones. And I don't know, they have a number of different, there's actually lots of funding opportunities through SPOR. I don't know if they do salary stuff, though, but this training program is funded through SPOR. So to get funding for research that's patient-oriented, which all their stuff really is, right, and add in a bit more concrete patient engagement, use the IAP2 framework and stuff like that. I think they really like it, right? It's a good opportunity for funding. But to just get a patient and do engagement, you should probably go through, if it's cancer, go through that patient family council. And I can I have a chat with them coming up. So the phone call I have is, I think it's got the patient and family advisory council people from Cancer Control, as well as the Alberta SPOR. I don't know if it has any AHS. Do you recall who's at that? Yeah, there's two or three people that I'm supposed to be talking with, and I'm going to get a clearer idea of, like, how does one get patient advisors and. It's which? Yeah. Yeah, and I think they want people to go through a systematic training and registration sort of procedure. There's also this thing called patient engagement research. It's called PACER. So there's this PACER program, and I don't know if it's through U of A or U of C.
U of
but
C.
Is it U of C? Yeah. And it's this. Do you know much about it?
I don't know.
Well, it's
I worked with Nancy on it. So.
Right. So yeah. It's a higher level of training for patients to actually do. So there's patient engagement within your research, but there's also patient engagement research,
mm-hmm.
right, which is research on how to best do patient engagement. And so the people who do that research are often patients, right, because that's the philosophy around doing it, is that you have to have these patient engagement researchers who are patients.
Yeah.
So they, of course, they get some kind of training they get, where they learn a lot about research methods, and they learn about methods specifically to do patient engagement. And so it's they're called... and. I use one of them. So when I chaired the Scientific Advisory Council for the Cancer Control Alberta Survivorship Implementation Group, anyway, we had a Scientific Advisory Council, and I had one of the PACER guys on, and he was really good.
Awesome.
But he was very highly used. Like, I was thinking of calling him up again. You know, he does more high-level policy stuff, because the PACER patients are really well-trained, and they're used on a lot of the policy groups, you know, the, I don't know, the strategic clinical networks, and you probably could. Yeah, well, what do you, how do you have to apply for PACER as a patient?
Yep, yep. So you can apply for their program if you wanted to just educate or become one of, so Nancy has it where you actually graduate. Oh my God, what's her last name? Marlon.
Yeah. So does she run it or something?
Yeah, she does, yeah, yeah. Yeah, so she runs it.
So they train researchers and patients, or just patients?
Yeah. So they train patients to become researchers, or
right.
to understand research as well, right? So.
So it might be redundant. Like, you might already know it. You already know it.
Well, you should reach out to. Anyways, it's a very lovely group, and you get to collaborate with a lot of other people too. So it's a very entrepreneurial. She's
yeah.
Awesome.
So they what they meet on a regular basis,
yeah.
and then they get kind of assigned out to different.
Yeah, so what Nancy does is she gets small contracts from different people in different organizations, and then you actually have to develop a research program specific to that. So let's say you were doing heart and stroke or whatnot, You would have to do come up with a research project for that specifically, and then you would have to present it. So kind of like.
So if we went to them and said, okay, PACER, we want you to help us make patient engagement research for psychosocial
oncology. Oh yeah, absolutely.
They would do that?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Well, we have to pay them.
Oh yes, yeah. but Nancy,
well, we can do that,
but,
can't we? I mean,
but the thing is, Nancy's really cheap. Like, she'll run programs from like $10,000 to $5,000. Like, it's extremely affordable.
So they would help us then come up with methodology to involve patient engagement in what we're already doing.
Well, she works alongside with you for whatever you
right.
want, right? And she's the sweetest woman ever. So,
because I think that's what the Alberta Spore Support Unit is supposed to do too.
Yeah.
Right, is to help you weave patient engagement methods and strategies into your research program.
Yeah.
But I haven't had a chance to have them do that yet.
Well, Nancy says that she knows of you and Barry, and she's been trying to reach out to you guys, but I don't know if any, well, and it's Barry, he's always busy.
Yeah, she should reach out to me.
Okay, well.
That's interesting. So, well, I'm going to be doing a lot of legwork on patient engagement over the next couple of months, because we're a year into this program and we're still not engaging patients.
Well, if you want that introduction, by all means,
yeah,
she's
yeah,
a sweetheart.
That's good.
Yeah, she's
that's
a sweetheart.
Good. And so maybe what would be interesting is you're going to the patient engagement thing, and I think Devish is as well. Is anyone else going to that Alberta Spore Support Unit patient engagement? Yeah, you're going? And you're going.
We have to.
Oh, you guys are going because you're funded by them.
Right? Yeah. I mean, we're excited to go, but I mean, we're mandated to go as well.
But it would be very interesting. So does that happen before our last class?
Mid-May.
Yeah,
oh, is it after our last class?
No, before our last class. Our last class is May 30th.
What would be really cool is if in our last class we could get some feedback from those of you who attended it, just to share any additional really important insights about patient engagement. Because I feel like I can't really tell you an awful lot. You know, I can tell you what the framework is, and you know, but I haven't done a lot of this either. So all I can tell you is that this is how you're supposed to do it. Should be done. There's good reasons for doing it. No, everybody go off and do it. Report back. Yeah, so that would be really actually quite good, because I think our last class is about implementation dissemination or something like that, right? Which would be totally relevant. You know, because patient engagement is another key.
Except for our last class is actually during CAPO, so I won't be here.
Yeah, but you'll be.
Yeah.
We might have to get the others to do it. Yeah, because I. We were thinking about going to CAPO, but decided not to go to CAPO, and I wanted to get all the classes in for the end of May. So, yeah, you'll be busy presenting. Okay. Yeah, so let's put that on the agenda, that maybe we can just get you and Devish to do it or something, and Julie. Oh, you'll be at CAPO too. Yeah. No, we're definitely good to get a little presentation about what you guys learned, because it looks like really lots of opportunities for learning specific sort of. So,
will you be there on one of the days?
I was going to try, but I've got all this other stuff going on. So, and I couldn't sign up for just one day. It was quite kind of expensive, right?
Yeah,
and they didn't
yeah.
let you do one day registration. There's only one day I thought I could maybe go. But I might still be able to talk to them about that one day. But the other 2 days I had too much other stuff going on. So next class we're going to talk about knowledge translation. KT. This is something I know more about. So we'll see you next week. Or I guess it's 2 weeks from now. Is that one?
Yeah.
Okay.